Well-known author, investment banker, consumer advocate, analyst, trader, Chris Markowski is the watchdog on Wall Street.
You want answers?
Exposing the lies and myths that the big brokerage firms, the mainstream press, and the government are pushing to keep Americans away from financial freedom.
You can't handle the truth.
Bringing America the truth about what really happens in the financial world.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're not here to indulge in fantasy, but in political and economic reality.
This is the Watchdog on Wall Street.
Okay, welcome everybody. Welcome. One of the things that I kind of pride myself on about this program, and there's no doubt, you know, we're the longest running financial program. You want to call ourselves a financial program in the country. No other program has lasted as long as we have. And one of the reasons why I believe that's the case is, again, we differentiate ourselves from everybody else. It's not a buy, sell, and hold show. And we talk about the bigger picture. We talk about issues that are facing this country, problems that we have in this country. We don't sugarcoat things here on the program. We're equal opportunity bashers here on the program. Now, we're currently 3-hour show. Many places around the country, they only take the first hour. Some take two, many take three. And I kind of organize the show, week in, week out, kind of talking about what's happening in the markets, your portfolio, gearing it around questions, what people need to know. That's the first hour of the program, because obviously the most people are listening at this point in time. Watchdog on Wall Street show. I got to change that up a bit today. I have to. Yeah, I found myself on Tuesday afternoon slumped in my chair, numb. Once again, numb, just not being able to move. That feeling, I don't feel like, you know, it's like I said, I don't even feel like working tomorrow. I don't feel like doing my show tomorrow. And again, you can't even compare. Again, that's how I felt. Imagine how all of those family, you can't. You can't even get your arms around it. Yeah, all these memories that I had of taking my kids to elementary school and all the events and coaching them and all the stuff that I've done with my children. Remember back in those days, because we're getting older now, much older. And you can't fathom, you can't get your arms around things like this. We have we've gone off the rails, and I've had no problem admitting this. Again, like I said, this program, you're not going to get rah-rah, America, we're number one, America, we're the best. You know, the first step in solving any sort of problem is admitting that there is one. That's the reality. We don't admit that we've gone off the rails. And again, these are things that I've talked about here on the show over the years, whether it be education, whether it be social media, whether it be the lack of attendance at church, the turning away from God. You don't think that this matters? What was going to happen next. And again, it was part of the reason why I was numb. I said, you just wait. The blame game is going to start. It's the Republicans' fault, the NRA's fault, and they're going to start pointing fingers. No, it's your fault. No, it's people, you know, when you try to analyze a problem and just take a societal issue out of the way, trying to fix something at your store, your business, whatever it may be, and you say, well, it worked for a while. What's changed? Gun laws in the United States used to be a hell of a lot more lax than they are today. back when my father went to school, they actually used to use shoot guns, learn how to use rifles in school. When I was in middle school, we did archery, for crying out loud. There's it's something else, people. There's something missing. We've turned away from who we are. America, let's be honest, we're not the greatest country in the world anymore. We're not. How are we the greatest country in the world anymore with the type of violence that we have here in this country? How many people have been killed in Chicago this year via shootings? This past weekend, another gut punch. A guy going to the city to go to brunch. Random shooting. Person who does the shooting has got a rap sheet the size of the old-fashioned New York City phone books. He's done so many things wrong, and he's out and about. They just let him go. What happened? Again, we have to analyze this. We have to look at this. Where did we go off the rails? Where did we go wrong? You know, we don't look at the consequences of a myriad of different things. Yeah, like, again, if you want to take a look at all of these shootings, these school shootings, mass shootings. Yep, young male, loner, heavily involved in video games, may have gotten bullied when they were younger. And again, I'm sorry, okay, with the bully stuff. Yeah, I was bullied when I was younger, too. Yeah, I was a bit of a chubby kid when I was younger, and I was uncoordinated when I was younger. I got bullied, too, you know, and guess what? Got over it. Things changed. Lack of involvement, parental involvement in kids' lives. You know, people, you know, you're going to have children. You're their teacher. Do you understand? You can't rely upon a school district to raise your kids. You got to be up involved in everything that your kids do. Everything. Who their friends are. Do they not have friends? Why do they not have friends? There's a complete breakdown here. Again, we often talk about this on the program. A complete human being, you need to overcome obstacles and achieve goals in life. Again, that builds up pride. Pride, accomplishing something. And the funny thing is, I've often talked about this here on the program. It's just rules in my household since the kids were younger. I don't care. I didn't care. Now, I happen to be involved in athletics, and that's something that I love. But I recognize that when I had kids, all kids are different. They may not love that. You had to do something, though. All my kids, yeah, they love sports. They're all, you know, they're heavily involved, all that stuff. But you know what? It didn't matter. I didn't care if they were going to be an artist. I didn't care if they were going to be music. But they're going to do something. They're going to do something. They're not going to sit in their room and play video games. And I'm sorry, okay, parents. You allow that, okay? That's on you. That's on you. You allow your kids to sit in a room and play video games where you get points by killing pedestrians and hookers. That's on you. Church attendance, way down here in the United States. No fear of God at all. At all. Do you think that this... Do you think that this person, do you think they went to church? Did they have any fear of God whatsoever? No. When I was elementary, everybody went to Sunday school or Hebrew school or Greek school. Didn't make any difference. What happened, people? All of these things, you can go back, you take a look, you think about all of the innovation, all the things we have. I lament it all the time. I talk about the smartphone. What a tool this is. What a tool. We walk around with the power of God's knowledge. You can, whatever you want to learn about something. What are people doing? Taking selfies. Taking pictures of themselves, trying to become influencers. Nobody goes to church. Nobody goes to synagogue. Not many people go to mosque. Not going to do that stuff. They worship at the altar of the Kardashians. That's the problem. Gun law? Oh, okay, do more gun laws. And listen, hey, I'm going to be honest with you. I'm a gun owner. I'm a gun owner. And I'm also a law-abiding citizen. Okay, I have handguns. I still haven't gotten my permits for where I live. So they stay down in Florida. Okay, I don't like that. Okay, but I'm not breaking the law. Do I believe that? Yes. Should you do background checks? Should you do a myriad of different things? Absolutely. Absolutely. I have no problem with that whatsoever. But what, you're going to change it from a waiting period to a week, 2 weeks? Do you think that would have stopped? You think that's going to stop this type of evil? No. Yeah, I've talked about this, my moonshot, when it comes to education here in this country and how kids are, you know, they're born into households where the parents don't care. And how we have to identify these kids and put them into situations, environments. I've talked about we should have public boarding schools. Nice ones. Nice ones where you say, hey, you know what? You know, we're going to try to take this kid. We're going to put him in this environment. Okay. And yes, it's going to cost the taxpayers money, but it's going to cost the taxpayer more. And it's going to be more of a problem for society if they turn out to be a criminal and we're going to have to prosecute them and incarcerate them. We don't think big like this anymore in this country. We don't. We've got a major flesh wound, okay? A mortal wound here in this country. And we've got people out there, politicians, what I want to do is stick a Band-Aid on it. Anyway. Got to take a break. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. I know, a different opening here for the Watchdog show. But again, I felt the need to do it. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. Become a part of the Watchdog on Wall Street family. Get to our website. Sign up for all of our great stuff. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back.
If I saw you in heaven,
bringing America financial freedom one listener at a time. You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street with Chris Markowski.
Welcome back, everybody. It is The Watchdog on Wall Street show. We're going to talk about, again, the markets, the volatility, bear market, recession, all of these things that you're all getting hit with. Left, right, and all over the place. I'm gonna take the we'll take the tack, the movement that, guess what, markets are going down further. We're gonna do worst case scenario bear market. Now, I don't necessarily believe that that's the case by any stretch. Could it happen? Absolutely. The easiest thing in the world for all of these wizards of smart stock analysts and big picture people that they parade on TV is to give worst case scenarios. Why? Why? Because if they're right, they're conquering heroes. If they're wrong, no one's going to remember because everyone's happy because it didn't happen. And they're going to say, well, I'm just warning everybody. Well, I'm just warning everybody. Guess what? Markets sell off, bear markets happen. I when I was a kid, it reminded me this past week. When I was a kid, played football in high school, and I love game day when it came to football, but practice was not one of my favorite things when it came to football by any stretch of the imagination. For whatever reason, our coaches just didn't make it fun. But anyway, I remember doing double sessions in August. Doing double sessions in August, mom drop you off at the school with a big lunch at 8:30 in the morning. You practice to 12. You take a lunch break, go back out in the high humidity and the heat. And I remember one of the good coaches that we had, wasn't a fan of my high school football coaches. Said, you guys got to embrace the suck. Embrace the suck. He'd be like, I know this sucks right now, but you got to embrace it, and it's going to be worthwhile once we get to, game day and you're ready to go and you're prepared. It was right. This again, embracing the suck is part of the reality of situations. It's part of investing. It is. Times like this happen. They do. Again, I look at all the economic numbers, all this stuff, and I try to figure out when things are going to turn and when they're not. I've never been good at it. I have. What was it? December 2020 or January 2021, I put out a column, Storms Ahead, talking about inflation and markets and what, things are going to get tough. Now, if I decided, because I saw it coming and I was right, but if I decided to time the markets and go to cash, sell everything at that point in time, you miss out all on 2021. And again, have things sold off? Absolutely. Do you own quality? Do you own quality in your portfolio? Unfortunately, many out there do not. Many out there do not own quality in their portfolios. It's funny. You see advertisements on some of the business networks there for certain investment firms out there, and they say, if you have a minimum of $500,000, if your portfolio is $500,000, why don't you contact us now? Well, I guess a lot of those portfolios are no longer $500,000. And I'm taking a look at some of these accounts coming in from these very firms, and they're disasters. They are disasters. Listen, I get it, being down with the market, protect your downside, but you have a portfolio full of high-flying junk that's down 70 to 80%. Come on. I mean, it's just ridiculous, quite frankly. And again, this is one of the things that we have been doing. We've been working our buttocks off at Markowski Investments. Yeah, long, long hours, which is fine. We don't care. This is what we're here for. And again, I want to remind everybody, no, you don't have to have a minimum of this. We help everybody out. If you have questions, if you have concerns, you need to contact us and contact us now. This is the same thing I was saying back in March, in April of 2020. This is the same thing I was saying back in 2008 and 2009. Same thing I was saying 2000, 2001, when all of these calamities, every single time a calamity happens, we'll explain it to you. We will make sense out of all of the nonsense. Because again, if you're following this stuff, it's nonsense. We'll be honest with you. We will tell you what the terrain has. We'll tell you what it's going to take to build your portfolio back. And we'll tell you as well if, your advisor's doing the right thing. If you've got somebody competent helping you out. I can't tell you, people. The decisions that you make when things aren't going your way, okay, it matters. It matters. The poor choices that I've seen people make in calamities in the past, this is the type of stuff that can set you back decades. Don't do stupid stuff. We're going to get into some investment hacks, if you will, when we get back. Don't go anywhere. You are listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street Show. Again, become a part of The Watchdog on Wall Street family, our personal CFO program. Sign up for it. Get all the help you need. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com or give us a call, 800-471-5984.
Taking Wall Street's liars, crooks, and cheats out behind the woodshed. You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street.
The beatings will continue until morale improves. Yeah, people feeling like that out there. Don't worry, people. It's going to be all good. I'm going to do some investment hacks right here. I've been putting together and doing a little bit of writing as of late. Again, trying to expand and help people out before they make stupid mistakes. I talk first about the entire culture of Wall Street now, big brokerage, investment banking. And let me tell you, this is not new. This is not new. You go back to Benjamin Graham and the Intelligent Investor actually talked about speculation and how many investors don't understand the difference between investing and speculation. And his fear, he wrote this, I think it was 1930s, 1940s. I can't remember exactly when that book came out. He said that, you know, he was fearful. He was fearful that the public was going to blame Wall Street when the markets go down because they don't understand the difference. Well, again, I've been doing this for decades. And I have, without a doubt, witnessed an industry that has gotten progressively worse for individual investors. Not better, not worse. Now, again, they're telling you it's awesome. Robinhood, only this is awesome. No. Again, I'm a Wall Street purist. Wall Street used to be a place where one would go. You need to borrow money. You want to raise capital to build a business. Place where you'd go to and people would manage your money properly. Put your interests first. The industry has become, if you will, a utensil for maximizing the number of encounters between the strong and the weak. You know, think of it this way. But, you know, my baseball team, they're in first place right now. The Yankees are in first place right now. Imagine if the Yankees were able to work the schedule out where they were able to play nothing but the worst teams in baseball every single day. Think about it that way. The Orioles, who else is not very good? I don't know. Pirates, I have no idea. That's what it's become. Smart money versus dumb money. Turning the entire industry from a wealth creation engine into a zero-sum game. That's the thing. Many people out there, that's what they say. Oh, well, it's a zero-sum game, like musical chairs. No, it's not supposed to be that way. It's not supposed to work that way. One of the ways that they've done this and one of the reasons why we've seen so much volatility out there. Leverage. So many money managers out there. They love leverage. They love it. They can charge greater fees. They can charge greater fees because, again, they can lever up portfolios. Now, again, borrowing money is fine. You want to go out and build something and create something that's over time. Okay? But when you borrow money, when you lever up to inflate returns. Basically, what you're doing is you're trying to move the future into the present. But it doesn't turn out that way. It gives you a short-term glimpse of prosperity that you haven't earned yet. That's another big part of it. Taleb talks about that all the time. You have all of these portfolios that are a disaster out there because of this. And another thing I talk about, I've talked about the zombification of America, zombie companies, and what it's done, because so many investors are knee-dipping. And there's different types of zombies out there. There's slow-moving zombies, and there's also quick zombies. You know what? We're going to get into the zombification and zombie companies and why you don't want to own zombie companies when we get back. I'm going to take a quick break. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. Again, become part of the Watchdog on Wall Street family, our personal CFO program, account repair kits, latest edition of my newsletter. I'm going to be putting the finishing touches on it this week. We'll get that out. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. Podcast every single day. We do the podcast. Sign up for that there as well. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com, or give us a call, 800-471-5984.
This is the Watchdog on Wall Street.
Well, it started out. All right, zombies. Beware of zombies. You got to look out for them. Two different types of zombie companies that are out there on the prowl. This is important, okay? You got to think about this. You got to think about what you own in your portfolio. The slow-moving variety. Slow-moving variety. These are zombie businesses that exist for certain reasons, such as regulatory capture. They're alive based upon the fact that regulations and government contracts keep them alive. They often have incestuous management. They have business plans. You take a look at the business plans and how they end up serving management, not the shareholders of the company. Some telltale signs of these types of companies. Outsized stock compensation packages that lead what? To stock buybacks rather than what? Capital expenditures. What's capital expenditures? Investing in one's business. The boards of directors of these companies, take a look at them. Oh, yeah. An incestuous bunch. Ex-politicians, executives, CEOs of other companies. This is so they can, you know, basically give themselves raises. If you're not growing your business, if your business is not growing, it's dying. If a company is not spending its money, if it's spending its money on its compensation packages and not investing in itself, it's a zombie. And again, the stocks like these zombies, they move slow. They're very difficult to kill. They stay afloat via their connections on Washington and Wall Street, but they go nowhere. And they are a drag on your portfolio. This leads us to our next type of zombie. These have been out and about. These are quick zombies. They're fast. Grow at all costs type. Earnings don't matter type. These zombies come around. These companies exist during periods of what? Easy money and all-out bull markets. The current version, they feast on venture capital dollars for as long as they possibly can before going public. long as they can. They want to go public. The whole goal for these zombies is to raise as much money, drive up the valuation, so we can get the greater fools out there to buy the stock and take out the venture capitalists, to take out the insiders. It's not about building a company. It's about building up a stock. These zombies are often built via clever marketing. Yeah. Not sustainable business models. No. It's get the insiders out. Great concepts, terrible businesses. Do you have zombies in your portfolio? Do you have zombies in your portfolio? Come on. You got to be honest. Okay. If you do, you need to make some changes. You need to make some changes. And listen, people, okay? Don't feel bad, okay? Some of the best investors in history have gotten taken by zombies. Hey, I mentioned several weeks ago on the show, Stanley Druckenmiller, he got involved heavily right before the dot-com collapse. Famous quote, I wrote it down. I bought $6 billion worth of tech stocks, and in 6 weeks, I had lost $3 billion in that one play. You ask me what I learned, I didn't learn anything. I already knew that I wasn't supposed to do that. I was just an emotional basket case, and I couldn't help myself. So maybe I learned not to do it again, but I already knew that. Get the help you need. Get to our website, watchdogonwallstreet.com. That's watchdogonwallstreet.com. Or give us a call, 800-471-5984.
You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street. The only man who is taking on the Wall Street establishment. You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street with Chris Markowski.
Welcome back, everybody. It is The Watchdog on Wall Street show. For my longtime listeners out there, I don't mean to annoy you, because when I get in to explain the personal CFO program here on the show, I don't. I know you've heard it a million times over the past 20-some-odd years, talking about what we do here on the program. But you do understand that we add new listeners and we get new stations all the time, and I'm going to get every week 500 emails. What does this personal CFO program you speak of? we help everybody out. You have access to us. You have access to our attorneys. You have access to our accountants, everybody that works with us. It's a family office for you. And basically, you're going to learn how to navigate through all the crap that we're dealing with now, because it's not always smooth sailing. Financial storms, corrections, volatility, being able to understand, work with the terrain. Not so much financial plan, but financial prepare. And this is what has made us successful over the years. So again, it's open to everybody out there. Take advantage of our personal CFO program at the site watchdogonwallstreet.com. Okay. We here, Markowski Investments, it's important. We look to build ownership. That's right. Ownership in great businesses with great ideas. Businesses that have certain economic and niche advantages, if you will. Firms also need to have great management. We own great companies based upon our expectation of performance over time. Okay? Get that. This is important. Performance over time. Business performance over time. One thing we don't do. Tell you what we don't do. We don't try to time the market. If there's a business out there, if it's a solid business, hit solid business. You can hit all the check marks for us at Markowski Investments. We feel that it's valued properly. Because, again, that happens too. It's sometimes there's great businesses out there, but they're just not valued properly. We're going to buy. We're going to buy. I don't care what the hell the market's doing. I don't care if the market's down 1,100 points. I don't care. Doesn't matter to me. Again, I'm not a stock picker. I'm not a market timer. What we do at Markowski Investments, our philosophy is to buy businesses. We are business owners. That's what we do. Owners and buyers. That's what we do. Now, again, we've got right now. Bulls, bears, what's going to happen? When should I buy? Yeah. If you're holding on, to great companies, do you really have anything to worry about when the market's inevitably, because it's going to happen, reverse for periods of time? Do you really have anything to worry about? And again, okay, your portfolio is going to decline during these periods of time. Guess what? My portfolio is down too from the all-time highs. Of course it is. But ultimately, the world doesn't end. World doesn't end, and I've said this a million times. Betting on the end of the world is never a good bet. It's only going to happen one time. Good. Great companies bounce back. There's a period of wild market fluctuations. Again, we forget about them. This is just a few years ago, for crying out loud. 2016. Oh, CNBC, I got to ask Warren Buffett what investors should do during these times of tumult. And he said back then, 2016, I would tell investors, don't watch the market closely. Investors that buy good companies over time will see results 5, 10, 20, 30 years down the road. If they're trying to buy and sell stocks, they're not going to have very good results. The money is made by investing, by owning good companies for long periods of time. That's what people should do with stocks. This past month, Buffett gave more perspective. Don't obsess over finding a perfect time to buy a stock. Go ahead and invest, and then observe over time if you should buy more or sell. This strategy leads to a higher chance of return. It alleviates some of the pressure of trying to predict the stock market. If the stock dips, its shares have become less expensive. So buy more of them. We haven't the faintest idea what the stock market is going to do when it opens on Monday. We've not been good at timing. We have been reasonably good at figuring out when we're getting enough for our money. Yeah. Jack Bogle, 2018. Buying stocks and holding them was the best way to invest because your emotions will defeat you totally. If you try to sell your holdings to avoid losses and get back in afterwards, it's not going to work. Stay the course. Don't let these changes in the market, even the big ones, change your mind and never, never, never be in or out of the market. Always in at a certain level. The conventional wisdom in the grand echo chamber known as business news when it comes to the over market sell-offs, tumult, bear market. This is when they want you to throw the towel in. They want you to sell. You're not trading in a casino, Chip. You understand? You're selling to someone else. You know what? I'm going to get into this when we get back. Don't go anywhere. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com is our site. Take advantage. We'll be back.
Chris Markowski is the Watchdog on Wall Street.
Uh-huh.
well-known author, investment banker, consumer advocate, analyst, trader. Chris Markowski is the watchdog on Wall Street.
You want answers?
Exposing the lies and myths that the big brokerage firms, the mainstream press, and the government are pushing to keep Americans away from financial freedom.
You can't handle the truth.
Bringing America the truth about what really happens in the financial world.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're not here to indulge in fantasy, but in political and economic reality.
This is the Watchdog on Wall Street.
Welcome back, everybody. It is the Watchdog on Wall Street show. Again, always honored to have you tuned into the program. I want to finish up talking about some of our investment hacks that I'm trying to get across to people out there so that they can not doing silly things with their money during times of tumult. You don't want to be a greater fool. You don't want to be a fool. You don't want to feel ridiculous. And again, this hits people at different parts of their life, and I've had to deal with this often. You know, one of the things that we've talked about is how there's so many investment con artists out there and so many scams that are run. And we talk about them here on the program. We try to educate you on what to avoid. But many of them don't even get reported. And they don't get reported because the people that are victimized, they're embarrassed. They don't want to tell anybody. They don't want to be made to be felt like they are a fool. And I got to be very, very clear. And I think, you know, throughout my years here on the program, I think that there's been, you know, I yell and scream about this stuff and I get upset and I talk about personal responsibility. And maybe I've turned some listeners off in regards to reaching out and getting the help that you need. Everybody makes mistakes. It's what you do after you make a mistake. That's what matters. Again, it's the old thing. Everybody is going to get knocked down. You're going to fall down in life. You're going to fail at things in life. What you got to do is you got to pick yourself up and learn. You don't want to be a greater fool. Being a greater fool nowadays is you tune into a lot of the news programs out there, and again, they're shoving some narrative down your throat. One of the big narratives when markets are in tumult and things are getting a little bit nuts, bear markets, market sell-offs, bear, whatever it is, okay? It's not going to end until what? They talk about capitulation. We need the VIX to go above 40. We need retail investors to get scared and dump all of their shares. We need them to throw in the towel. Once we get that, then we know it's over. Of course. Why wouldn't it be over? This is what they want you to do. They want you to sell your stock. Again, you own companies, right? You're not trading in. You're not going to a window and trading in a casino chip. You understand? For every seller, there's a buyer. Think about this for a second. Do you know of any other store or market that, can you think of one out there that when it holds a massive sale, everyone runs out the store? Yeah, they want to come back and pay higher prices. Can you think of a market or store where that happens outside of what? Oh, gee whiz, the stock market. Who is buying right now? Who's buying quality companies when markets sell off? When greater value is created? Smart money. Smart money. I've said it past 2 weeks here on the program. Past 2 weeks on the program, J.P. Morgan in bear markets, stocks return to their rightful owners. Do you want to be a rightful owner, or do you want to be one of the greater fools? That's the difference. One of the first four Markowski investments, investing rules of the road. You want to invest like you're wealthy. You want to invest like you are J.P. Morgan or you're Warren Buffett or whatever it may be. You want to do the same things that they are doing. Do you think that they are panicking right now? Well, J.P. Morgan's no longer with us, but do you think that they're freaking out over situations like we have now? They're not. So you shouldn't either. Anyway, we'll talk a little bit about dividends. Dividends. Talk about history. We look to historical points here, and oftentimes you'll watch again on the news programs, well, in this bear market here, it took from this point to this point, and this had to happen here. Every situation is different. It's different. The comparison to the 1970s. How can you compare this era to the 1960s? How could you? The music from the 1970s was way better. But anyway, other things. Think about the differences between the 1970s and today. Not the same thing. Okay? But again, I understand, and you got to learn from history. Doesn't repeat itself, but it rhymes. Rhymes. Now, throughout Markowski Investments history, okay, decades we've been in business, you got countless. I forgot. I go to my archives of columns that I have written. And again, I wish I had all of my shows archived, the topics from all of the shows that I've done over the years archived. I don't even have it all digitized yet. A lot of them are on CDs going back 20 some odd years ago. But anyway, countless market panics, sell-offs, bear markets. I mean, they come to my Asian financial crisis, long-term capital management, flash crashes, the European debt crisis. Each and every time, again, you might as well chime up REM's song there. It's the end of the world as we know it. Again, never bet on the end of the world. It will only happen once. Over the past several years, and we've warned you about this in the same way that we were warning people, during a dot-com run-up that, hey, you know what? You got to tone it down with all this stuff. What do you know, Markowski? Look at this stock I just bought. GameStop. I got diamond hands. Yeah, okay. Okay. And again, these are, either new listeners to the program or new clients who don't know any better. They don't know what they don't know. Too many investors. They had a ferocious appetite for grow at all costs stocks. This notion out there that the party would never end. The music eventually stops when it comes to these things, people. And we talked about zombie companies last hour on the program. And again, you've got to beware of these things. And the reality is when the party ends, okay, the party ends, the music stops. That the market can have long periods of time where it's in a bit of a hangover. It can last a while, the markets as a whole. However, even decades, because, again, I saw several articles over the past couple weeks. Will this be a lost decade for stocks? Will this be a lost decade? I don't know. I don't think so. But if it is, it is. We'll deal with it. Even decades that are maligned with malaise, substandard returns, you can still do relatively well. You can have decent returns in relation to what's going on out there if you focus on the magic of compounding and focus on dividend paying securities. Rule number one, I mentioned my Markowski Investments investment rules. Rule number one, compounding is the royal road to riches. Now, if history, say history does rhyme, we could expect lower returns for the overall market, muted market returns moving forward. Reality is that we have exceeded historical norms over the past decade. Again, do I think growth is going to come back? Can things change very, very quickly? Can this deglobalization and moving supply chains back into local areas, could there be a lot that could happen? Could an invention come up that could change it? Absolutely. But again, let's say market returns are going to be more muted. Okay. So what? You can still do well. I mean, let's go back to the last time. Let's go back to the last time Wall Street took out the fire hose and started spraying money at companies. Go back to the dot-com era. Took 15 years. 15 years before people actually got over the lessons of that period of time. Dividend-paying stocks should always be the foundation of one's portfolio. With the terrain that we're looking at, the environment we're looking at moving forward, quite frankly, they should play an even larger part. Got to take a break. We're here to help. Get to our website, Watchdog on WallStreet.com, our personal CFO program, our podcast. All sorts of great stuff right there at the site. Take advantage. We also have a 24-hour-a-day help hotline, 800-471-5984. That's 800-471-5984.
You should believe in math, not magic. You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street with Chris Markowski.
Welcome back. Welcome back. You can go back, and again, let's just do index. 20 years. 20 years. Numbers don't translate well on radio, but at times I feel like I have to kind of go through numbers here. Hopefully, you get certain people listening out there, the light bulb will go off and they won't make mistakes. Let's just take the S&P 500. 20 years. Fully invested. You don't do a damn thing. You don't do a damn thing. You're close to 10% return. Close to a 10% return. If you happen to try to time the market and you missed the 10 best days, 5.3 was your return. You missed the 20 best days, 2.6. You missed the 30 best days, 0.44. You missed the 40 best days over a 20-year period of time. You're down 1.5%. Do I know when the best days are going to come? No. No, I don't. No, I don't. Never claim to. Again, it's an exercise in futility. Okay? Don't involve yourself with this. I'm still getting quite a few questions regards to cryptos. Davos this past week. Yep. Davos was, I guess, from what I heard, there were no Russian oligarchs allowed at Davos this past, obviously. No Russian oligarchs. And the Russian oligarchs at Davos, you know, they throw the big swanky parties and they get nuts. So they weren't allowed there. But I guess crypto ruled the roost. Oh, everywhere. Crypto sponsoring this, signs for this crypto, signs for that crypto. And I'm seeing more and more stories in newspapers around the country about people, kids, taking their money and I'm using this in air quotes, investing in crypto. There's a difference, people, and this is important. I mentioned Benjamin Graham, 1930s intelligent investor. He called us to, there's a difference between investing and speculating. Stop calling it an investment. In my humble opinion, okay? I work under the guise of the Securities and Exchange Commission. I have to be brutally honest here, like I should be, not to my clients, radio show, tell whatever it may be, or they're going to drop the hammer on me, and rightfully so. Stop calling. You shouldn't call crypto an investment. It is speculation. Is what it is. And there's a difference between the two. Kids out there. I wanted to buy, you know, we wanted to move to Westchester, and I had saved up $50,000 for a down payment, but it wasn't close to the 20% that I needed. So I figured I'd trade crypto. You know what? Other people out there. You know, the parents taking kids' money, college money, putting it into crypto, hoping to, you know, oh, geez, mama needs a new pair of shoes, kid needs a college education, let's put it into crypto and see if I get it. Ah, bum, we're busted. Are you kidding me? I've got three kids. Perspective for you, okay? We manage money for people all over the country. Man, people from all over the country been doing this for decades. One could say, know what the hell that I'm doing. I've got a kid, my son in college right now. Do you think that I have his tuition money that I'm going to have to send very shortly for next year? Do you think I have it in crypto? Do you think I have it in stocks? No and no. No. Crypto is pure speculation. Stocks are long-term investments. And guess what? Guess what? Markets can sell off for a period of time. So if you need to have access to this money, you need this money over the short term, you don't take it and speculate with it or invest it in the stock market. I don't like having cash. I don't, but I do. I had a daughter that's going to school, college, and I don't want to. There's different time periods that you have. And you don't go doing things like this. How many times I've had that question over the years? Mr. Markowski, we're looking to buy a house. We're going to make a down payment on a house next year. What should I invest? What stock should I buy with the money? You shouldn't. You need that money. You need cash next year to down payment a house. You don't. You don't do that. There's too much risk involved. And you know, again, I watch these people. They parade them. I can't stand it anymore. The amount of crypto people that they bring and they're parading on TV and they're wearing their ties with the Bitcoin symbol on it. Have you actually ever taken a look at who these people are, the type of money that they manage? Huh? Have you taken a look at their CV, their resume? See how long they've been around? It's a racket. Do you understand? It's a big stinking racket. That's all it is. There's not a single person listening to this program right now that can explain it as an investment in any way, shape, matter, or form. It is a zero-sum game. Period. The end. Period. The end. There's nothing built. There's nothing created. There's just belief that Dogecoin or Doggy Coin or this coin or that coin is worth something. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Again, become part of the Watchdog on Wall Street family. Take advantage of all the great stuff we have. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. We'll be back.
You're listening to the Watchdog on Wall Street. Bringing America financial freedom one listener at a time. You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street with Chris Markowski.
I guarantee I'm going to get a bunch of emails with, you know, people saying, I made money on Bitcoin. I made money on cryptos. Guess what? So did I. Doesn't make an investment. Doesn't make it an investment. It's speculation. It's a gamble. Stop calling it an investment. That's like somebody saying, hey, Markowski, I killed it at the blackjack table. I'm just going to keep taking. I'm just going to take the 401k and I'm going to go to the casino. I did well last time. Really? Really? There's a difference. I want to mention this as well. I'm seeing a lot of these going to be part of the whole ESG stuff out there. Morgan Stanley had an ad they've been running. They've got some lady talking about young people, and they're engaging on social media with ideas, and they want to be able to invest in things like climate change and protecting the environment. And I watch this ad, and it makes me want to throw up in my mouth. It really does. Ladies talking with her hands. She's all excited about what young people are doing. Yeah. Young people right now crush themselves. Yeah. Young people that went to Robin Hood and had diamond hands and all that, they made stupid mistakes with their money. I'm telling you, you got young people, they do this all the time. It's like a racket. Now they want you to get involved in all of their ESG crap because they can charge you higher fees. That's all it is. Oh yeah, guess what? Tesla, you're not green enough. You're not on the ESG. Are you out of your mind? No, this is not what you want to do. Okay? It's not what you want to do. You know, investing isn't about hitting like buttons. Ooh, that company's neato. Oh, it's a non-profit vegan restaurant. Ooh, that sounds like a good investment. Are you out of your bloody mind? Unless, of course, you want to lose. And the thing is, when you're younger, you don't want to lose. Just play with a compounding calculator. If you do moderately well, over decades, 8% return, and you're investing on a regular basis, and you're doing the right thing. It's not a matter of if, it's just a matter of when you are going to be wealthy. You can't take big losses. That is one of the biggest mistakes out there. Biggest mistake, what a conventional wisdom. Oh, you're young, you can be really, really aggressive. And they got people being aggressive in what? Their 401ks? They want to start allowing people to put 20% of their 401ks into cryptos? No. No, that money you can't touch. You can't touch it until you're in your late 50s, 60s. So all you need to do is moderately well. You don't need to knock it out of the ballpark. You just need to do moderately well, because the most important thing about investing is time. It's time. Asset allocation over time, proper asset allocation over time, you're going to do well. Anyway, yeah, again, they're all doing it now. Now Goldman Sachs is trying to start their own little trading nonsense. And again, that what they will do, they'll do is, that, again, high fees can take advantage of the greater fools. What did I say first out of the program? Okay. Increase the amount of encounters you can have with dumb money. Smart money, meet dumb money. Dumb money, give their money to smart money. Again, don't be dumb money. Anyway, I gotta get into some ripoffs and scams. We haven't done this stuff for the past couple of weeks. Here's one. I saw it and I was like, hey, I warned people about this one. Securities and Exchange Commission announced fraud charges against EIA All Weather Alpha Fund Partners. Sounds like a tire, All Weather. And their sole owner for a multi-year Ponzi scheme that included the misappropriation and loss of $39 million in investor funds. I'm sure the guy had a nice car. Sure he had a nice car. I'm sure he had a nice watch, nice suits. I'm sure he had a pretty good golf game. Pretty good golf game. And I'm sure they talked, he's a high-performing fund manager. You should probably work with them. Come on. People, Madoff had the same gig going on. The same exact thing. Anyway, let me take a break. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Again, get all the help you need. Get to our website, Watchdog on WallStreet.com, or give us a call, 800-471-5984. We'll be back.
Taking Wall Street's liars, crooks, and cheats out behind the woodshed. You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street.
Oh, yeah, a little Elton John. He's going on tour again this summer. I gotta catch him. I need to take the kids to see him. Anyway, welcome back. It is The Watchdog on Wall Street Show. A couple more here. Stories, ripoffs, and scams we'll get to. Securities and Exchange Commission fining Wells Fargo. When are they not fining Wells Fargo? $7 million for anti-money laundering lapses. The SEC could go into any major bank in the country and they can find money laundering lapses. You got to file these suspicious activity reports. If something's amiss, I mean, honestly, money's going to flow in. It's going to get wired out. Account here, whatever. I mean, that's what these companies do. And quite frankly, $7 million fine. What is that? Is that their monthly bar bill at the local tavern? I mean, it's nothing. It's a cost of doing business. Saw this as well. Again, I warn people about schlock brokers out there, certain schlock brokers and advisors that, again, they've got their own radio programs, fly-by-night radio programs, buy, sell, or hold shows. Many of them also put out newsletters. Yeah, day trading. This guy was a Morgan Stanley broker, and he put out a day trading newsletter. Yeah, and sent it and took to. I'm sorry. I find it hard to believe that Morgan Stanley didn't know. You can't do that. You're falsifying your returns. You can't do that. But again, at the time, he was probably doing pretty well when it comes to commissions. And you wonder why all the, eventually you get these bad brokers at these big firms, they eventually get caught years and years after pulling off a scam. Well, their managers get paid their bosses get paid based upon how well, how much money their brokers are producing, churning and burning. What are their commissions like? If they're doing great, you know what, then they're doing just fine. Yeah, remember the movie Wall Street, the end of the movie, Bud Fox? Bud Fox gets caught, and the Securities and Exchange Commission, police officers there in his office, and his boss, the Kane there, says, the moment I laid eyes on you, I knew you were no good. Wasn't that long ago in the movie. Okay, first part of the movie, the sales manager was like, all right, you're a loser. You're pulling your weight. Then he's doing tons of commissions. He gets his own office with secretary, and it's all taken care of. Yeah. It's the same thing. Nothing's changed. That's how it operates still to this day. Here we go. $7.5 million arbitration award. This is from a defrauded Merrill Lynch client. I'm looking at the internals in this one and what this broker did. And again, if you tell me that Merrill Lynch didn't know exactly what was going on, I have offices. I know everything that's going on everywhere. It's ridiculous. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back.
Chris Markowski is the Watchdog on Wall Street. This is the Watchdog on Wall Street.
Welcome back, everybody. This is the Watchdog on Wall Street show. Always honored to have you tuned into the program. You know, I know I've talked about this. I hope it's not boring you. I don't. I got to understand. I know I got a lot of people who listen to this program for years, and many of the topics we've covered here on the program, but I do have to react based upon the questions and the emails that we're getting and what's going on the ground, what's happening here in the country. And I talk a little bit about higher education, college education. I had to be 2009, maybe 2008, 2009. I was on CNN with Don Lemon. That's right. My one and only time I was on with Don Lemon, and the topic was the high cost of college education. And these are, again, 2009 prices. Parents today would love to have 2009 prices and how out of control the entire thing was getting. And I dropped a truth bomb on Don Lemon and the CNN audience saying, you want the higher cost, you want the price of college education to come down. Real simply, get rid of student loans, get rid of financial aid, all of the, not, unless it came from the school, of course, and they were giving it away. Any sort of subsidies, any sort of crap, you get rid of that, then the college and university has to price their product based upon what people can afford to pay. I blew him away. He didn't know what to say. But the CNN audience, again, definitely skewed to the left. You should have seen the emails that were hitting me. Oh, my God. And again, it's just, you can't answer this stuff because you can't argue with idiots. They don't want to hear it. But I saw this story. It was talking about why there's a movement to cancel student loans, but not credit card debt or mortgages. Well, number one on their list was the system is broken. The system is broken. It's a broken, they love saying it's a broken system. It's not fair. It's not right. Yeah, it's broken. It's broken, but forgiving debt's not going to solve the problem. It's still broken. You're not solving anything, are you? No. They're going to just keep lending money out, and it's going to do the same thing again and again and again. Most loans won't be repaid anyway. That's one of the reasons why they're saying there's a movement. People are not going to pay it back anyway. So what you're saying is that people just say, hey, you know what, I'm just going to stop paying my mortgage, and, you know, all these banks aren't going to want to default on everything out there. What are we going to do? So they're not going to pay it back? You're just going to let it go? Are you kidding? And again, they're talking about, oh, there's one creditor. It's the federal government. No, it's not. It's a taxpayer. It's a taxpayer footed this bill. Oh, and of course, education is a common good. Yeah, but you know what else is common good? Small businesses. It's common good. Is not that restaurant in your town that employs people common good? Is not the mechanic shop in your town common good? Aren't they common goods as well? But again, you're not going to forgive the loans that the people took out and the risk that people took out to go ahead and do those things. I've done this before, once or twice here on the program, because I get the question. I get the question from people on a regular basis, clients. But what I do, my rules, three kids. I have every certain rule in my house, very simple, was, you know, I told my kids, I said, whatever you want to do, you want to go to college, okay, I will cover your undergrad. I put money away. I will cover your undergrad. But first and foremost, you got to tell me why you're going to school. You got to give me a reason. It can't be to find myself. And if you come up and you say to me, hey, you know what? I want to do film studies. Guess what? You're not going to NYU. You're not going to NYU because that is a high risk major. Okay. Yeah. Big reward if you happen to hit it, but it's high risk. So you know what? You're going to go to a state school if that's the case. And again, you know, certain kids getting scholarship money, sports, various different other things. All of these things are taken into account. But again, I save money from the time that they were very, very young. Okay. Put money away on a regular basis. I have it. It's taken care of. That was the deal that I had my kids. But again, I'm not paying if their grades suck. Okay. I'm not. And they know that too. It's life in the Markowski household. It is what it is. But again, you know, you have to understand that this is an investment. And I'm here to tell you, okay, if your kid wants to study chemistry, your kid wants to study chemistry, does it matter that if they go to the University of Maryland, which is a great school, or they go to Harvard, which is another great school, even though the price is different? No, they're going to both come out chemists. You're there to learn, people. It is a tool to get yourself a job. All of these bull excrement majors that are out there, it's all because of funny money. Do you understand? And the funny money is coming from the taxpayer. That's the reality. Well, you go to these schools and they've got rock climbing walls and all these crazy amenities there. Well, guess what? Guess what? Taxpayers paying for this. And let's not even get, I talked about it before, grad school, unlimited borrowing. The money goes to the student, for crying out loud. Again, I got to remind everybody, okay? Colleges and universities are businesses. They're hedge funds. They're hedge funds. They own a bunch of different businesses out there. And they're there to make money. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. What we do, okay, is part of financial preparation, understanding higher education, dealing with your kids. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back.
You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street. Well-known author, investment banker, consumer advocate, analyst, trader. Chris Markowski is the Watchdog on Wall Street.
You want answers?
Exposing the lies and myths that the big brokerage firms, the mainstream press, and the government are pushing to keep Americans away from financial freedom.
You can't handle the truth.
Bringing America the truth about what really happens in the financial world.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're not here to indulge in fantasy, but in political and economic reality.
This is the Watchdog on Wall Street.
Yes, it is. Welcome, 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 everybody. It is the Watchdog on Wall Street show. And I look at all the stuff I want to discuss today, and I recognize that I'm not even... I've done 2 hours here, and I haven't even gotten through my first hour prep for the program. But anyway, it's all good. It's all good. But this is why we do the podcast every single day. I really enjoy doing it. Again, I try to keep it short and sweet. Try to keep it around a half an hour every single day. Some important topics here and there. And take advantage of it. You sign up for it at our website at watchdogonwallstreet.com, amongst all the other stuff that we have there. Let's talk a little bit about the ongoing Tesla, Twitter, Elon Musk drama that's taking place. I knew this was going to happen. I think we called it here, if I'm not mistaken. It was either here on the radio show or the podcast. After Elon Musk said he was going to start voting for Republicans next time around. And again, they took offense to him buying Twitter and, messing around with that. I said, you just wait. There's going to be a sexual harassment accusation that's going to come out of nowhere. Sure enough, that's exactly what would happen. And they're already, because he's from South Africa, he's already being, they're trying to make him into, you remember Lethal Weapon 2, where the bad guys in Lethal Weapon 2 were the South Africans? He's trying to make him into those bad guys from Lethal Weapon 2. I've got diplomatic immunity. Remember that? Anyway, electric vehicles. Battery costs right now, they're predicting the cost for an electric vehicle battery could be up by 25% by 2026. Now, put that into perspective. Okay. New technology comes out. I'm going to take a technology from when my younger years towards my childhood. I remember how many people remember. First, it was the Betamax. Betamax, and that was a little smaller tape. But again, it was a business mistake by Sony that owned the technology. The Betamax actually had a better picture, better quality than VHS, but they didn't license out the technology. So VHS, they licensed out that technology to everyone. That's became the standard because what? The price came down. Little brother, remember how big those VCRs used to be? I mean, that was a major freaking component on your, next to your television right there. The tape would come out the top. But the price kept dropping. Price kept dropping. How about the first flat screen? How many people had a plasma TV? Yep. First plasma TV, that thing had to be, close to $3,000. And man, that thing weighed a ton. That thing weighed a ton. Glass screen. I remember how you had to mount that thing with this on the wall. Oh, my God. Make sure that you get all the stuff because that thing was coming down. It was heavy. Now televisions are basically disposable for crying out loud. They're so inexpensive. But here we got this wondrous technology where we've got an administration that is suggesting that we should all drive EVs. Yet the more that they're becoming popular, the more people that want them, yet the price is going up. Something's amiss here. Something is amiss. It's not supposed to be this way. It's, again, we've explained this on the program. Neat stuff. Great technology. You put the cart before the horse. Again, we're talking about major projects like mine. These are commodities. This is stuff that you need. Input costs. Until they come up with other ways of making batteries with different materials, this is not going to change. The price is not going to come down. The price of these cars are only going to go up. How could it be any other way? Hey, you take a look right now. We have chips going to everything, right? Do supply chains. Right now, currently, actually kind of a delve into supply chains. Right now, currently, 80% of semiconductors are supplied by Asia. 80%. 80% supplied from Asia. That's a problem, isn't it? Okay? Especially when you got whack job. And he's a whack job. I'm sorry. Xi Jinping. They're going to shut down a city of 20 million plus people. Lock them in their houses. Shut down the I think, and God willing, hopefully we've learned our lesson from this, and we're starting to see more and more plants announcing openings. Europe, finally. This past week, Spain going to put another chip plant there. Yeah. You want to have other outlets for important stuff, because we all know chips go in to everything. The price of computer chips. The price of computer chips, I mean, you think about where they were, what they were capable of doing, and what we have now. We walk around in our pocket with supercomputers. Go back and take a look at what I remember when I was a kid, I wanted a computer. We couldn't afford one. But I wanted a computer so bad. You know what my dad would do, because he was a school teacher? He would bring home a computer from school on the weekend so we could mess around with it. And then he would bring it back. And remember how heavy and big those things were? But anyway, you know, even the Christmas catalogs, you know, you get, oh, what do you want for Christmas? And you get those Christmas catalogs, and then there'd be the part there where they'd have the computers. And you go back, and I remember one was like $800-900. And you play with an inflation calculator, see how much that is today. And we're walking around with, you know, a phone / camera / recording device / computer in our pockets, and you can get them for under $1,000. This is the issue, okay? EVs, technology's great. Man, they're fast. They can do all these things, but we don't have the materials. And unless we get some sort of, you know, plan to go ahead and start approving more of these mines, fast-tracking these things. You think that it's easy to build a mine, to put up a mine in the United States? Because, again, if you take a look at the mining of some of these rare earth minerals, it ain't clean. Okay? It ain't clean. Matt Damon and his buddies are going to be making movies about this. Okay? Let's just leave it at that. That is the reality. Nobody wants to have this near their home. So it's an issue. I want to talk about this story I saw as well. There's a lot of interesting stories out there, which are great business lessons. And stuff, I share this stuff with my kids. This is, you know, you got to learn how the world works. And again, it was a popular target of mine over the past couple of years. And again, it's a target of mine based upon the direction they decided to go and how they presented themselves. I don't have any, I think exercising, working out is the greatest thing. And it's Peloton. Well, it wasn't long ago where you had, again, whenever you see politicians and business owners out with like golden shovels about ready to, pretending like they're about ready to, oh, we're about ready to take the first shovel of dirt, and they all get their picture taken. Yeah. Something bad is going to happen at that point in time. They got an Ohio factory. It's half built. And I don't even know if they're going to even complete the thing, for crying out loud. And it was all there because Peloton completely lost their minds. They must have thought, I for some reason, that the pandemic would never end. And everybody in the country was going to buy a Peloton. Yeah, I thought about this a bit and kind of controlling supply and demand when it comes to a company. A company that I've owned on and off over the years in portfolios, Harley Davidson. And Harley Davidson, pretty darn good. So pretty darn good at, you know, saying, okay, listen, this is how many we're making. And that's it. That's it. There's a bit of a scarcity sale that's involved, which puts a premium on their product, obviously. Now, again, Peloton discounting the price of their equipment and whatnot because they've got tons of them. They've got tons of them. And again, they built up too much ahead of time. It's okay. And this is, Wall Street does this too. This is grow at all costs. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. You know, sometimes if you make people wait for certain things, we just don't have it. They're going to want it more. They are going to want it more. Yeah. Remember back in the night, speaking with a bouncer. You're talking about how they, you know, again, that's how they operate, like the lounges. They weren't clubs. They were lounges that, you know, and they still, because it's the way it is in New York. And they had the bouncer out front, got the earpiece in. You got the velvet rope out front, in front of the lounge that was there. And there'd be a line. And, you know, you get in. I didn't do lines. I didn't. We'd find ways to get ourselves on a list. So we get in there and you go in and the place is half empty. The place is half empty. And I said, why would you do that? Again, it makes people want it more. They see the line out front. I got to be there. That's got to be the place to be. I got to go. Nothing wrong. Nothing wrong with doing a bit of a scarcity sale. And you want to grow. I get growth is great. But if you put out a high quality product and people are going to want it, they'll wait. Better than doing that than getting stuck with all sorts of excess inventory that you can't move. Anyways, past week, snap. It's like the telephone for kids nowadays. It is. Last weekend, I went with my son to the lacrosse quarterfinals at Hofstra University, and his phone ran out of batteries, and he was making plans later. Dad, can I use your phone? What do you need my phone for? I got to text my friends. It wasn't texting. It was Snap. He downloaded the app to Snap. He signed in. And that's how they talk to one another. So obviously, we talk about the users. Obviously, it's being used. But you take a look at the numbers and what they're looking at moving forward. And I said this from the get-go when it came to Snap. Snap went public, and we're like, this thing is going to tank, which it did. And it just tanked again. It's below the price that it went public. Again, you've got to make money. And again, they pull in a couple billion dollars in revenues, if I'm not mistaken. But the type of advertising that they sell, it's basically brand recognition. You understand? It's not direct response. It's not direct response like Facebook and Google are able to pull up. This is more brand recognition. And when things start slowing down a bit, companies start saying, hey, we're going to reevaluate. We're going to reevaluate how our money is being spent. And guess what's going to get cut? This type of stuff. Anyway, got to take a break. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. Become part of the Watchdog on Wall Street family. Take advantage of all the great stuff we have right there at our site, whether it be our personal CFO program, account repair kits, newsletter, podcast, you name it. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. We'll be back.
Days when the rains came down in the hollow.
The only man who is taking on the Wall Street establishment. You're listening to the Watchdog on Wall Street with Chris Markowski.
Should I stay or should I go?
The nicest emails I got. And again, I don't know if it's BS or not, but this is saying, I've been listening to your show for the past several months. I learned more listening to your show than I did getting my MBA. Now, yeah, I don't know if this kid was paying attention during his classes. I don't know where he got his MBA, whatever it may be. But, again, we try here on the program to explain to you how the world works. How the world works, how businesses work. And, again, it's help you evaluate. It's going to help you from getting ripped off and scammed. I mentioned last segment, we talked a little bit about Snap. We talked about Peloton and Peloton growing too big. And in a kind of like a juxtaposition type of a story, different types of companies that have added too much warehouse space or added too many workers. The story of Walmart and Amazon, some of the things that they're reporting. Now, Walmart and Amazon are different, it's a different business than Peloton. Okay, Amazon does a million different things. One of its profitable businesses, its web services, its cloud services. But the retail aspect, and again, Walmart and the retail aspect, they can afford. They can afford to say, hey, you know what? We're worried about having enough workers. We're going to add workers. We're going to add the space. But it's amazing. It's just to see how nimble they are. They're doing a really good job with this. They signed leases that they could sublet or they could get out of. There's a big Amazon center going up not far from where I live in Syosset, Long Island. That's, they're hiring. They're going full tilt there. But there might be other areas of the country where, you know what, we might have to sublet the space. Maybe if demand comes back, we'll be able to take this space back. It's being able to adjust to these different things, which makes these companies successful. Do they take a hit sometimes when they have it? Sure. For a quarter, maybe two. Might they have too many workers at this point in time? Yeah, maybe. But they're going to lose some via attrition and a myriad of different ways. So again, they're able to get their way through it. Anyway, I want to talk a little bit about real estate. Some of the home builders had some pretty impressive numbers, despite the fact that new home sales plunge 17% in April. Again, what did you think was going to happen? Huh? What did you think was going to happen? Now, and why do you think the home builders are doing okay? The home builders are doing okay. They're doing better than okay. It is, again, they set the price of the house. They set the price. They've obviously figured out how to account for all the higher input costs, commodity costs. And guess what? If it gets out of control, gets too expensive, well, they just put it off. We can't get our hands on those materials. And, all the kind of letting people know things might get out of control. They might take longer than we expect it to take. It's fascinating to me. It is, because I remember how quickly they used to be able to put out homes in Southwest Florida where I used to live and how long it takes now. But why do you think new home sales are down? It's interesting. I grabbed some numbers. You want to go back? Let's go back to January 2021. January 2021, 30-year fixed rate mortgage, 2.65. That's basically what I'm paying. Okay. The average price of a home, I think at that point in time, median price was a little under $400,000. Today, the 30-year mortgage rate, five and a quarter. Right, let's say 5.25. Average new home price is much, much higher than that. I got different numbers. Some say 450, some say 500, some say even higher than that. So if you basically assume a 20% down payment, okay, depending on where you are in the country, because again, it's a big real estate market. You don't like to take the entire country and put it into one basket. This is why I'm giving various different numbers. Assuming a 20% down payment, you're basically talking anywhere between a 50 to 95% increase in the monthly payment. That is the reality. So again, home prices, they have to come down, and they will. They will. Once get some of the supply issues taken care of, they will come down. And quite frankly, that's a good thing. It's not a bad thing. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. Again, become a part of the Watchdog on Wall Street family. Take advantage of all the great stuff we have. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com or give us a call, 800-471-5984.
Chris Markowski is the Watchdog on Wall Street. You should believe in math, not magic. You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street with Chris Markowski.
Welcome back. Yeah, we mentioned this. We mentioned last week, talked about on the podcast as well. This moronic idea that they just tax people more and it'll make inflation go away. No, it won't. It won't. It will make things worse. It's going to make things worse because more money will come in to the federal government and they'll spend it. It's not as if they're going to take the money that comes in and pay down debt. God forbid. As soon as it comes in, it's going out the door. It's going out the door. Now, again, everybody's patting themselves on the back right now, talking about, yeah, deficits have come way down. Deficits have come way down under Biden. Well, all this COVID expenditures are going away. The deficit has gone down, but you're still spending more than we're taking in, and we're still $30 trillion in debt. What do you want, a participation trophy? I tell you what, start patting yourself on the back when you balance the budget. And there is no way you're going to be able to balance the U.S. budget via taxation. You can't. You would have to, and again, many politicians like Elizabeth Warren and certain other progressives would love to confiscate everything that the billionaires have. If you were to just take it all, it wouldn't be enough. Wouldn't be enough. So it's a spending issue. And the only reason why the deficit is down is because all of these spending programs are going away. Child tax credit, all this COVID stuff. And hey, there's a big one that's going to be going away soon. And this is going to be right around the midterms. Right around the midterms. All of the additional Obamacare subsidies. That's right. There was COVID Obamacare, helping people to pay for their Obamacare. Even though they're already getting subsidized, they were subsidizing to an even greater degree. So everybody's Obamacare premiums are going up a lot. A lot. And we'll see. We'll see what the government does. They're going to obviously, you know, try to can't allow this to happen. People are going to lose their church. Yeah, you're going to hear that normal thing. The number was $2,985,636,000,000. Federal tax collections set record through April. Not enough? Not enough? Well, again, we got to send 40-plus billion to the Ukraine, you know. Anyway, I'll try to get to that. We'll try to get to that a little bit later on the program. It's another topic we could delve into. You want to talk about waste? The IRS is so far behind the eight ball. IRS is so far behind the eight ball that you could get millions and millions of delayed tax returns. Not to mention the fact, there's this other story out there where they destroyed all of these tax documents. They got destroyed somehow. So we the people, think about this for a second. We the people of the United States of America are paying billions in dollars in interest to people waiting for their returns. I guess they paid too much. Yeah, I'm not making this up. Billions of dollars in interest. I got people say, well, that's right. You know, getting the money. Listen, I get that. But where is the money coming from? Okay? Where's the money coming? It's coming from us. Anyway, I'm gonna mention this. I did touch on this on the podcast. I got called out by one of my listeners. I have a whole bunch of listeners out there, different areas of the country, that basically they love busting my stones. Okay, they love, for whatever reason it may be, and they understand my skin. Again, nothing really offends me. And a lot of them are Italian, and they know that I'm half Italian and half Polish, and they love making fun of my Polish heritage all the time. And it's all good. It's all good because, again, I'm a big believer that stone busting should be an Olympic sport. It's hard for my wife to get her arms like around how guys speak to one another. I mean, she happens to think if I don't respond to someone's text immediately, somehow I'm going to be on some naughty list. Men are from Mars, women are from Venus. But anyway, I love the stone busting. And the listener, you know, because I always do the Godfather references on the program, brought up the fact, said, couldn't believe, I was disappointed in you, Markowski, because I didn't bring up the Godfather story, the reference, when it came to the markets. And basically it was, well, the markets in the movie, what happened was Michael breaks bad, and he's going to kill the Turk, and he's going to kill McCluskey, the police chief, and he's down in the basement with Clemenza, and they're having a little chit-chat, and Michael's trying out the little 38. And Clemenza says, hey, you know, these things happen. It's going to cause a war. These things happen every 5 years or so, 10 years. Helps to get rid of the bad blood. Helps to get rid of the bad blood. And again, it's pretty apropos because this is what I talk about when it comes to recessions and slowdowns. It does. It's like the lymphatic system. It gets rid of the gunk. Companies reevaluate things that are working and things that are not working. But yeah, they were making fun of me because I didn't remember that. But anyway, I thought it was clever. Got to take a break. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. WatchdogOnWallStreet.com. Don't go anywhere. We'll be back.
Bringing America financial freedom one listener at a time. You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street with Chris Markowski.
Welcome back, everybody. This show, in case you haven't picked up on it, we are small business advocates. We always have been. The bulk. Now, I'll do a Godfather reference for you. I've got selfish reasons why. No. The bulk of our business clients that we have around the country, they don't let me even own small businesses. Okay? I'm not managing the money. I'm not managing the stock options for CEOs of Fortune 500 companies. That's not what I do. They got their buddies over at Goldman Sachs and those guys. They get taken care of. That's a big club that I'm not a member of. Okay? My clients are small business owners from all over the country. And there's a story talking about how small businesses have losing confidence in the U.S. economy. Portion of small businesses that expect their revenue to increase in the coming year fell to 61%, down from 79% in May of 2020. I get that. You go back to May of 2020 and, kind of slowly but surely trying to come out of the pandemic and, you know, looking forward. And, you know, a lot of the bad news that's out there, inflation issues facing small businesses. But even still, at 61%, it's not bad. Not bad. And again, anecdotal, I speak with small businesses from all over the country. Are they grinding? Are they working harder? Are they, you know, having to put in more hours? Yeah, they are. Yeah, they are. But again, they're, yeah, it's all good. It's all good. They feel that they're going to be just fine. They'll deal with it. That's what these types of people do. Okay. Problem is in front of you. Okay. You can choose to bitch and moan about it, or you can do something about it. Which one, which camp do you want to be in? You want to whine and complain, or you want to deal with it? Dealing with it's much, much better. Much better course of action, if you ask me. Anyway, we got to get into some of this green stuff. Gas prices, high energy prices that are crushing everybody here, there, and everywhere. And yes, the Commander-in-Chief, the Commander-in-Chief of the United States of America praising high gas prices. Yeah, we'll get into that when we get back. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Become a part of the Watchdog on Wall Street family. Watchdog on WallStreet.com. Or give us a call, 800-471-5984.
You're listening to the Watchdog on Wall Street. Taking Wall Street's liars, crooks, and cheats out behind the woodshed. You're listening to The Watchdog on Wall Street.
You know, we could change the name of the show. We could call it the Don't Doubt Me Show. We could call it the See I Told You So Show. Nah, it's spiking a football a little bit too much, quite frankly. And again, never been a trash talker. Never been a big believer in spiking the football. No. Yeah, listen. Okay, I was a middle linebacker and an offensive lineman, so I did score one touchdown. One touchdown in my life. I caused a fumble in the end zone, and I recovered it when I proceeded to give the ball to the referee. It's my nature. Yeah, I don't like any of that stuff. But anyway, neither here nor there. We've got Biden and praising high gas prices as a part of an incredible, incredible transition. And I quote, when it comes to gas prices, we're going through an incredible transition that has taken place that, God willing, when it's over, will be stronger, stronger, and the world will be stronger and less reliant on fossil fuels when this is over. Yeah, he said this at a press conference in Japan. Told you. This is by design. Okay? And the people that are behind this, they don't care about gas. But when was the last time? You don't think Joe Biden has bought gasoline? He's been in government for how long? For crying out loud. He takes government cars. He doesn't pay for his own gas. None of these people that are behind it. Do you think that they're the slightest bit worried about it? Do you think that they blink an eye? Even these wealthy people that are behind all this stuff, having to pay $5 plus, probably going to be much higher than $6, if not more, by August. No. No. Again, they told you what they were going to do. You talk about hiding in plain sight. Hiding in plain sight. I think that the only people that actually noticed it was probably my program. Maybe, I don't know, maybe Hannity. I don't know. I know Limbaugh did. Stephen Chu. How many times have I mentioned this? Stephen Chu, Barack Obama's energy secretary, basically coming out and saying, his first energy secretary saying, we want our gas prices to be as expensive as they are in Europe. Now, European gas prices, much more expensive. To the point, again, they, a lot of the cars there, they could still get manually operated cars in Europe. They're small. Now, again, a lot of it also has to do with the fact that in certain parts of Europe, you have very narrow streets and whatnot. When we go on vacation, you're driving in Italy and Greece. Many of the places you're driving in, driving's like a negotiation. You know, you go, I go, you know, you're kind of talking to people with your hands. But anyway, neither here nor there. They're paying about $10 a gallon over there right now. $10 a gallon equivalent. They wanted this. You go back to Barack Obama, and he had his American Recovery and Reinvestment Act, where the government was subsidizing a myriad of green companies, right? Myriad of green companies out there. What was his name? What was it? He's the guy on CNN. Is he still on CNN? Jones is his last name. They came out that he was a communist. He was supposed to be Van Jones. He was supposed to be the green energy czar. And they found out that he had, you know, communist leanings, and they got rid of him. And they put money into Fisker. And we all know about Solyndra. And remember Barack Obama getting into the Chevy Volt, putting his seat belt on and driving 10 feet. And all of this stuff that was subsidized, where'd it go? Where'd it go? You're watching EV manufacturers. They're gonna start dying off pretty quickly. Unless they get government subsidies. Okay? These companies were reliant upon Build Back Better. And I trust me, make no bones about it. Even General Motors, big American car manufacturers, are sweating right now because Build Back Better didn't pass. And they need those subsidies. They need the taxpayer to help their fellow taxpayer buy cars so they can make those cars affordable. This is all by design. Senator Josh Hawley, you can see him go on YouTube, tears into the energy. I don't know what qualifies Jennifer Granholm as energy secretary. I know she was governor of Michigan, but she's energy secretary. Does she create energy? She ever worked on an oil platform somewhere? But she is. She is. And she's a part of the big club. She's a, you know, big-time politician. And Hawley went into her because basically she came out and she said that it was Putin's fault. Putin's fault. You see a politician start blaming something, some person, some political party, some country. They're full of crap. No, no, no. Whose fault is this? It's your fault. No, you know, as a matter of fact, it's our fault. It's because we put these people into power. We were energy independent. The price of gasoline, the price of oil has skyrocketed before Vladimir Putin lined up his troops outside of Ukraine. Prices had already gone through the roof. Joe Biden comes in office. First thing he did, January 20th. January 20th, he gets inaugurated. He cancels the Keystone Pipeline. Very first thing he did. And was that Putin's fault too? No, Putin's thrilled. Putin was thrilled. I'm going to get this Nord Stream 2 thing done, and we're going to ship all this stuff to Europe, and they're going to be completely reliant upon us. Then we can invade countries. Look no further than D.C., people, if you want to see the ultimate screw-ups and why things are the way that they are. Anyway, got to go. God bless everybody. Thank you so much again for tuning into the program. Again, we invite each and every one of you to become a part of the Watchdog on Wall Street family. Get to our website, watchdogonwallstreet.com, or give us a call, 800-471-5984. We'll see you.
Chris Markowski is the Watchdog on Wall Street.